Everybody stand up with them. Let's praise the Lord. Clap your hands, those people. Shout to God as you walk up the drive. Praise the Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's make some noise. Come on you. This is going to change your life.
This is going to remove burdens. This is going to destroy yokes. This anointing will empower you for service. It will equip you to live in this age that we're in. And you're going to need all the anointing of God that you can access to live successfully in this age. We've never been in a time in history as we are now, and we need to be anointed by God so we can do His will victoriously and be victors and not victims of the age in which we live. God created you to succeed in this day, in this time, in this hour. Amen. Created to succeed. Chosen by God to be here now. This is your time. This is our time. This is what God prepared us for. Praise God. This is it. Hallelujah. We've been in school a long time. But I'm telling you what, it's time to graduate to a higher degree right now. A PhD. Praise in the highest degree. Praise the Lord. Come on. Give us some more praise. You can't praise Him too much. You can't praise Him too much. All He's done for you. You can't praise Him too much. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I believe that when we praise God, we are emptying ourselves. We're releasing something out of our lives. And that place that we've emptied is the place God's going to fill. Hallelujah. And I believe you praised Him from your heart tonight, from the bottom of your heart. And I believe God's going to start right there, filling you up to overflowing with the fresh anointing of His Spirit. Praise the Lord. I don't know about you, but I'm going to raise my hand to make sure that I get all that I came to get here tonight. And I'm going to leave with a blessing here tonight in Jesus' name. I have purposed to leave here with a blessing. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There are miracles in the room tonight. The miracle workers in the house tonight. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. All things are possible with God. Praise the Lord. And nothing's impossible to him that believes. I know that we're believers here tonight. I can feel your faith. I can feel it. Praise God. I can feel the unity of the Spirit. And where there's unity, there's power. And there's unity here, and there's power here. And I'd recommend, if you ain't unity, get in unity. Praise the Lord. You don't want to be a short circuit, because that short circuits get real hot. Am I right, electrician? You don't want to be a short circuit. You don't want to resist God, because if you've ever seen a wire that's overloaded, that's resisting, it gets real hot. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, I pray for you. Why don't you pray for me? Ask God to use me tonight. Father, I yield myself to you. I didn't call myself. I didn't equip myself. I haven't sent myself. And I'm not here to endorse myself. I'm here to lift up the name of Jesus and to glorify you. I'm available for whatever gifts, graces, or spiritual endowments that you wish to release through my life. I'll do my best to yield to you. And I will be the first to give you glory for everything that you do, for every heart you touch, for every life you change. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, do your thing here tonight. Holy Spirit, fill us with your language of ecstasy. And let us worship you with the tongues of men and angels. Let us go beyond anywhere we've ever been before and experience more and 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 more. I feel as though I'm standing on some unfamiliar shore and looking out across a crystal ocean, and all I see is more and more and more and more and more. There's no limits to what God can do. That's a good word tonight, Pastor. take the limits off your faith. He's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we ask to think. How many of you think some pretty big things? He can top it. Hallelujah. How many of you ask for some pretty big things? He can top it exceedingly, abundantly, above anything in your wildest imagination can conceive of. If you can think it, God can top it. Hallelujah. Okay, God, go ahead and top it. The temple there where he had been offering up the incense before the table of incense, prayers, and the angel had appeared to him. And when he got out of there, his mind must have been blown because he couldn't say anything. Praise God. And when a preacher can't say anything, you know something serious has happened on the inside of their mind. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. And the Lord raised my son Jesse up from the dead. Jesse is a miracle child, stillborn. And the power of God manifested in that little cabin in the woods. I was a midwife, and the bright glory of God filled that place, and the electricity of God, I'm telling you, the lightnings of God flashed through me.
Yeah.
And baby Jesse came back to life, and it blew my mind. For days afterwards, my neighbors would try to have conversations with me, and I couldn't answer them. I'd start crying. I just have to walk off into the woods. Praise God. How would you like to have your mind blown so much that you'd be speechless? What a miracle that'd be. 3 days without Christians talking? Wow, that would be a sign of a wonder for sure. 3 days with no complaining? That'd be as big a miracle as the Jews walking around Jericho for 6 days. Not complaining. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord another hand. I'm thankful for that word. I wanted to take that back and share it with Pastor Dick. It'll bless him. So I wanted him to hear it in your voice, and I'll make sure I get a tape or a DVD or something on that. Praise God. I sense revival coming. My prayer all of my adult life, and you may be seated, God bless you, all my Christian life, my prayer has been to be in a revival, a real revival that we couldn't shut down. A revival we couldn't walk away from. I've been in some protracted meetings that went on for a few weeks. I think the longest I ever went was about 3 months. But in the end, we were able to walk away from it. You know, we felt like we'd done what God had sent us to do, and bless God, and a lot of good things happened. But, you know, it came to an end. My prayer is that I would be in a revival that wouldn't come to an end. Yeah, I've been praying that for many, many years. And I feel like the time is close. All I have to do is look at my birth certificate, and I believe that revival is coming quick. And so come quickly, Lord Jesus. Praise God. In my lifetime, I want to be part of it. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I believe God is answering that prayer. I believe I'm going to be a part of a revival that is going to eclipse anything that we've thought or imagined.
Yeah.
I believe that. I've read about Azusa Street, and it's so fascinating. And, as I read it, I felt like I was there. Just, I have a vivid imagination anyway, and I could see the glory, see the kids playing in the glory, see the air glistening with the Shekinah of God. Yeah, I've been in some meetings. I've had a taste of it. Then it's the needs. But what God is getting ready to do is going to be exceeding beyond anything that we've ever experienced before. The latter days are greater than the former days. Can I share a prophecy with you? I believe in prophecy. God sent the church apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to edify and to equip the church. I believe in prophecy. Now, there's a lot of squirrely prophecies in the world. A lot of false prophets. We have to have enough Bible sense to be able to discern what's right and what's wrong. And the internet is not your best source for prophecy. I said that as nicely as I could. So when I was a young man, I just got filled with the Holy Ghost. On fire for God, I'm still on fire. And I would pass out tracts, and I would, play and sing, beat a tambourine, do anything I could do to participate. Go to the church, clean up the church, help my old pastor, Lester Chisholm. He'd go around Arkansas and Missouri setting up his gospel tent, and I'd help him set it up. And man, those were good old days. Bluegrass gospel music, we all sang. We were in revival, to tell you the truth. And I missed it when we cycled out of that. Those were glorious, glorious days. And the anointing of God was on me. And everywhere I went, I visited a lot of churches, especially when I went with Brother Lester trying to help him. I'd carry his Bible, I'd carry his banjo, I'd drive the truck, I'd do whatever I could do. I even would string the lights in the tent. I'd have to shimmy up a post, a pole in the tent, the big top. Wasn't that big, but that's how skinny I was back then. I could go run up that pole and string up the lights. Do anything, set up chairs. And I visited these churches, and someone would prophesy to me, it seemed like every church I went to. I'd just be sitting in the back. And I could feel it coming. Somebody was tuning up, getting ready to prophesy. Right. I mean, even in churches where they didn't believe in prophecy, somebody would prophesy. And I hated it. Well, the word was, it was always a variation of this. Yea, says the Lord, I'm going to raise you up in the latter days. You have a latter day ministry. Your latter days are going to be greater than your former days, says the Lord. When you're 23 years old, you don't want to hear God talking about your latter days. That's not even on the radar screen. What do you mean by latter days? These are the best days I've ever had, How about now?
Yeah.
But the Lord kept on telling me, in your latter days. In your latter days. And the interesting thing is, no matter how wonderful things have been, no matter what kind of miracles and blessings that I've been a part of, I've been in some of the most wonderful moves of God in the world. This thought would come to me, this isn't it. This is good, but something better is coming.
At
high water marks.
Amen.
Glorious times. I would think, God's going to do something that's going to top this.
Yeah.
You believe that? You sincerely believe God can top what he's done in the past? Well, that's what he promised. That the latter days will be better than the former days. Father, help us to be a part of this latter day. We don't mean that in a fatalistic sense. We mean that in a glorious sense of the anticipation of the great miraculous things you're going to do in the earth. We're not prophets of doom and gloom. We're rejoicing with the expectation of you doing things that are going to be far beyond anything anyone has ever seen on this planet in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to make a confession to you. This prophecy means a lot to me because I don't know what it is about prophets. But it seems like those of us who do stand in that office don't really like it and don't really want to do it. And some of my friends who truly stood in that office are same as I am. They go through these spells where I'm not going to prophesy to another person. I'm not going to say, thus saith the Lord. I don't even want to pray for them. I just preach and go out the back door. Any of you preachers ever have that done? I don't know what happens to us. For one thing, most prophets scare me. They're so weird. And I think, God, do I need to be weird to be a prophet? Do you have to be weird to be a prophet? Is there any such thing as a normal person who's a prophet?
and you tell people you're a prophet right away, they think, oh yeah, you're weird. I heard about you, prophets. Well, I don't like being tarred with that brush. I'm not weird, I'm not straight. But every now and then I'll give one of these cycles to the Lord and say, you're not obeying me fully in a prophet's ministry, take me to the woodshed. You know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
There's a woodshed for preachers, so I've been in one.
Yeah.
And the Lord dealt with me very strongly, very sweetly, about focusing more on the prophetic side of my ministry and my calling. And looking back through the years, I have to confess that the great things God has accomplished through my feeble attempts to work with Him has been through the prophetic.
Yes.
I would say I'm a journeyman teacher, preacher. You know, I put a few scriptures together. God's given me some insights, a lot of experiences. But not too many people come back and say, wow, you know, that Sunday school lesson you taught me changed my life. Usually they say that word you have changed my life.
Hallelujah.
I was sitting at my desk yesterday, and the Lord said, He called a person's name to me, a gentleman from San Antonio. He said, you call Odell Allen right now. I stopped what I was doing and called Odell Allen. He said, my God. He said, 5 minutes ago, I prayed that God would have someone call me with an encouraging word. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes. Words.
And a word like that is just so precious. A word fitly spoken in due season. It was the right time. Timing is a big part. You say the right thing at the wrong time, you get the wrong result. But when you say the right thing at the right time,
yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
There was a young man who showed up at our church in Tulsa, Oklahoma years ago, many years back, by the name of Tommy Novak. Tommy had heard about Faith Christian Fellowship somehow, I think, on television or something. This was back in early 70s, maybe 1978. And Tommy felt like he was supposed to move to Tulsa and be a part of our church, just from hearing that little broadcast. Tommy had an amazing story. He had experienced horrible abuse, physical abuse, verbal, emotional abuse, sexual abuse. He was actually imprisoned in a basement by his parents. He'd been beaten so severely that to this day, he limps when he walks. He'd been beaten so severely that his arm wouldn't extend. He was beaten so severely that his eyes, to this day, don't look in the same direction. And his face is somewhat misshapen. Seems like one side of his face is pushed to the other side. And he talks with a lisp. And I remember when he came to FCF, he was so thrilled to be here, to be around a Christian family. He was so hungry for love and fellowship. And every time he turned around, here's Tommy. He just wants to be a part of everything, every conversation, every group. He wouldn't say anything, he just wanted to be close. I knew some people didn't know how to deal with Tommy. He was a little awkward. He would even get shunned at FCF. I think we had a lot of love there, but even at FCF, he'd get shunned because sometimes we don't know how to treat special needs people. And Tommy did anything he could do. He'd work and pick up stuff outside, he'd sweep the floor on the inside, anything. Just anything we get to do. He was just so eager to do something for Jesus. One day, I'm in the pulpit, and I looked out at Tommy, and I saw him in the spirit. And I said, Tommy, stand up. I wasn't preaching or anything, I was actually getting announcements. And I said, Tommy, stand up. And I said, Brother Larry's looking at you through the Spirit of God right now. And Tommy, I see your future. I see future Tommy. And you look so good. You're well dressed, Tommy. You're a businessman. You're in a business suit. And you're prosperous. Tommy, God's going to make you a prosperous businessman. He's going to bless your life. And Tommy, He's going to give you a wife. Tommy goes, oh, thank you, Jesus. And nobody said amen. They just stared at me. I can read your thoughts, but how dare you manipulate this young man? Give him false hope. Prosperous businessman, a wife. I can feel it. You know, Jesus felt people's unbelief. And I said, Tommy, come to my office right after service. As soon as service is over, come to my office. He walked in, I'm sitting at my desk. I have a yellow piece of tablet and a pen. And I'm finishing up the affidavit, writing that prophecy as close as I could, word for word, but it was still fresh. Filling the whole page. I said, Tommy, I'm writing down that prophecy as close as I can, word for word. I'm getting ready to sign it, David. I said, Tommy, anything that's given, a written document that's given due consideration and attested with a signature and a date is legally binding. I said, this is a legal document. And if every word of this prophecy does not come to pass in your life, Brother Larry's a false prophet. You never have to listen to me again.
He's 90 rather than 80.
Sister Loretta heard about Tommy. I mentioned him from time to time. I was real happy that a few years back I was invited to Tulsa, having a wonderful meeting. Brother Tommy showed up. I saw him when he came in. I was very happy to see him. You would have been too if you'd been there. At the appropriate time in service, he said, Brother Larry, can man testify? I said, of course you can, Brother Tommy. Stood behind the pulpit, he reached in his pocket and pulled out a fading yellow piece of paper that was over 25 years old. And he read it in that halting voice that he had. And he said, I want to let you know that every word of this prophecy has come to pass in my life. He said, my restaurant at Brookside is so prosperous that people wait outside in line to get into my restaurant. And he said, I had to expand and double the size and put in more tables. And now I have a second restaurant. And he said, I'm so prosperous. He said, you know, the Lord has given me a business mind. I got a business mind. And he said, I'm in negotiations right now with some people who are putting in a shopping center. They want me to put in a third restaurant. He said, I don't know if I want to do that or not. I've got to look at the numbers. And he said, oh, one more thing. I would like to introduce you to my beautiful wife. He had her stand up. Praise God. Hallelujah. I've seen the power of prophecy when those words are released from heaven, the impact that will have. Now, those words don't have the same impact on all people. Paul told Timothy, remember the prophecies that were spoken over thee, that by them you might war a good warfare. Yes. Just because you got a good word doesn't mean that it's automatically going to come to pass. It is a conditional prophecy, yes. And you have to meet the conditions. Yes. First condition is you have to receive it.
Yes.
I mean wholeheartedly.
Yes.
Jump off the ledge, take the leap of faith, yes. Receive it. And you have to treasure it. You have to remember it.
Yes.
And you have to be willing to do some warfare.
Yeah.
It's a good thing every now and then to be able to look at the devil and say, hey, I've got a sure word of prophecy, the word of God, but on top of that, I have a rainbow word that God gave Brother Larry Huggins. Hallelujah. Yeah. And God said, I can say that to you tonight, my latter days are going to be greater than my former days. Yeah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus said, receive a prophet because he is a prophet and you get the prophet's reward. Jesus said that. It wasn't an association of prophets that got together and said, you know what, let's try to talk everybody into believing this. It wasn't some cartel of prophets who decided to feather their own caps. God sent the church apostles and prophets. Now here's the deal. Without apostles and prophets, pastors, evangelists, and teachers, the church will never mature.
Amen.
the church will never grow into the living tabernacle that it's supposed to be. Because this is God's plan and this is the way it is. This is God's idea. Prophets, apostles and prophets are God's idea. He said, don't do my prophets any harm. I thought I'd throw that in there. Jesus said, receive a prophet. One translation says, because he actually is a prophet. Or if he really is a prophet, he or she. And you shall receive a prophet's reward.
Amen.
Now, I don't know what you can expect if you're listening to false prophets, people who are channeling lying spirits. I don't know what you're going to get out of that. Confusion. Disappointment. But if God has set a prophet in your life, he's a true prophet, it behooves us to recognize that and receive him.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
That's
right.
The word receive there is the Greek word lambano. It means to seize and to hold fast.
Yes.
Like Hannah grabbed a hold of Samuel and wouldn't let him go.
That's right. Amen.
He's walking, she's dragged, he's dragged. She won't let him go. That's lambano. That's to take a hold of. I have people that hooked up with my ministry 30 years ago and beyond that. We're talking about Dick Brunell tonight. Almost every other time he gets up, he reminds people, he says, Brother Larry was my pastor. Brother Larry's church was the one that helped start FCF. Brother Larry's the one that took me on my first crusade in India. And he's held on to that.
Yeah.
And recognized
it. Absolutely.
Praise God. That's good thing.
Yeah.
If he didn't believe in me, I couldn't help him. You can't help people that don't believe in you.
Right.
So this, the onus is on the believer. Receive the prophet. I've got a word for you tonight, but I want to give you one more testimony. Sometimes God blesses the testimonies just about as much as he does anything. In fact, a big part of the Bible is just testimonies, isn't it?
Yeah.
The woman at the well, the woman with the issue of blood, the woman called from the home, those are testimonies.
Okay.
Testimonies are great.
Yeah.
I was in Brockton, Massachusetts, and had a glorious Holy Ghost service. Like the one we're in right now. Started moving into that prophetic realm. The glory of God was manifesting. I mean, I was saturated. I could barely walk at the end of the service. I've seen Warren Barton like that every now and then. You know the feeling. It's like, I don't know how you describe it. For me, it's like a heavy, wet overcoat. Like an overcoat is wet. Strange analogy, but
thank you, Lord.
So I was under the anointing. Went about as far as I could go, and then I slipped out of the service. And the pastor and the workers were wrapping up the service. And I went back to the pastor's office, and I'm sitting behind his desk. Well, just a minute later, a couple of his key ministry of helps people came in the door to check on me, see if I needed anything. You know, water, we always need water, breath mint. We all need breath. We want to make sure it's anointing, it's not to keep it out. And I'm still under the anointing. I'm sitting behind this desk and I look at this couple there in the mid-30s. And I stare at them. You know what happens when you're scared of people, they stop and stare back. And I said, why don't you have children? Now, I didn't know that in the natural, that was the word of knowledge. But it was spot on. They start crying, unconsoled. Boy, you're talking about hitting a hot tub. Prophets do that. They'll hit the hot button. I mean, I cannot tell you how many people I have made cry. Just over and over. It gives me right out of the chute. I'm making somebody cry. I had a biker come up to me the other day. He was in my service. He had his, the colors on his jacket, the rockers and all that thing. Big, bad, outlaw, 1%er type guy. And he came up and he said, I never cry. I cried today. I never cried. I said, give me a hug, big, bad biker. He gives me a hug. I said, a real hug. He gives me a better hug. Yeah. So I said, why don't you have kids? And they started crying. And through their tears, I let them cry for a while. They said, the doctors say it's impossible. We'll never have children. I said, do you believe I'm a prophet? They said, no. The doctors told you you'll never, ever have children. I said, you want to hear what the Holy Ghost says?
Yeah.
I went, I said, you're not going to have a child. You're going to have two. God's giving twins to you. Power guy came on, they fell to the floor. Her on top of him. They're out. I walked out of the room, shut off the lights, and closed the door. I don't know what happened, but 9 months later, they had their twin babies. Hallelujah. I don't know where that took place, but 9 months later. A year later, I'm sitting in church on the platform, and the pastor and his wife and this couple came up and they put a baby in this arm and a baby in that arm. And those babies just leaned in and put their cheeks on me. I had them like this. They just, like I was their grandpa. And these gay dudes, you know what, this sounds like something you'd do. They said, we want Prophet Huggins to bless the children he's responsible for. Touch not my anointed. Let's stand up. Praise the name of Jesus, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus, singing about preposition confusion. I'll give you a little English grammar lesson. I am preoccupied with prepositions. I have been for 43 years. I remember my school teacher, Mr. Bridges, in the seventh grade, drilling prepositions into us. And he did sentence diagrams and all that. And the way he explained a preposition wasn't the academic way. You know, it's a preposition is a relational word that's usually modified. It always modifies a noun. He didn't say that. He said, think of a preposition as you would a little squirrel. And the squirrel could go around the chair, over the chair, under the chair, through the chair, beside the chair. Because prepositions show relationship. They're words of relationship. You know prepositions. For, by, through, among, into, Those are all prepositions. And they're very important in the Bible. I'm an in-him teacher. I'm a Pauline teacher. I teach everything Pauline. I'm a New Testament guy. I mean, to the max. And the thing that captivated me years ago, and I first experienced this revelation, enlightenment, really, when I went to work for Kenneth A. And he had a little book called In Him. And I did the art, the mechanicals, and you know, the typesetting and proofreading, and getting it ready for it to be a booklet, really. And that book changed my life.
Yeah.
A little tiny book, In Him. Brother Hagin talked about In Him scriptures. And In Him scriptures contains a prepositional phrase that tells us something of who we are, what we have, and what we can do through Christ.
Yes.
I'm a new creature in Christ.
Yes.
I can do all things through Christ. I'm complete in Him, who's the head of all principality and power. Who has made unto you and me wisdom and sanctification and righteousness. And Brother Hagin said, well, there are 120, 130 in Him scriptures. Well, I spent all of these years since then. I'll give you $100 for this. I just gave my last one away.
Oh!
I gave you $5 for this. That's it. I think it would exist if it worked for me, but I'm the one that did that. I get credit somewhere. I'll give myself credit. I have discovered, uncovered 500 in Him scriptures. I've got the biggest list of anyone I know. I printed them all up, and I brought them to church one night, and we were in a 600-seat sanctuary, and that list went all the way around the room. Let me tell you something. God emphasizes important things through repetition.
Yes.
And the more He repeats something, the more important it is. He's trying to get it through our skulls. That finding out who we are in Christ and what we can do through Christ and the virtues that are ours by reason of our union in Christ are very important. And He says it and 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 says it. Till finally, hopefully, we get it. I am a new creature in Christ. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I can do all things through Christ. I come behind you no good gift in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Praise God. I've had preachers try to talk me out of my list. I tell them, get your own list. I spent 43 years getting this list together. I know you preachers. You go out there and preach my sermons and write a book and leave me out of it. You'll have a whole new television broadcast. I'm kind of stingy that way. I know, I need to get that fixed. You thought I was perfect, didn't you? Oh, Lord, deliver me from being sticky. I'll give you my money, but my list is more important. Seriously. I have people tell me, well, you know, there's so much in the book of Revelations. You know, people spend all their time in the book of Revelations. You know what that means? It means it's not revealed.
Right.
Yeah. And they'll say, well, there's all this numerology and types and shadows and symbolism. Yeah, you can put it together differently every day. That's the problem. Everybody puts the symbols together differently and the numbers together differently and they come up with different interpretations. A lot of confusion. You know, there's two parts of Revelation that I've paid attention to. Number one, it says there's a blessing on everyone who reads it. At the end of the book, it says there's a curse on everyone who takes away or adds to. So what do? You read it. And you don't reinterpret it. And I told this same person, they said, oh, there's all this symbology and everything. I said, you know what? I go through the literal stuff. I can do all things through Christ. No symbolism there. You don't have to interpret that. What part of that don't you understand? You are complete in Him. Hallelujah. Praise God. When you begin to confess this to yourself and say this to yourself, something amazing happens. You begin to believe that you really are a new creature in Christ. You really believe Father.
Amen.
Folks don't even know what part of the Bible to meditate. That's the part to meditate. Yes. The part that describes who you are, not who you used to be.
Right.
I can't sing those songs like I'm a broken vessel. Oh, shut up. And you got born again, you became a chosen vessel. Hallelujah. A vessel of honor. Meet for use in the master's house. Not even make jokes. Stop singing about how broken you are and say, I'm complete in Him. Do what I do. Just study the Psalms when you're singing. I very seldom sing a song the way it's written. But if it doesn't line up with Paul in the New Testament, I won't sing it.
Amen.
Just tell, well, you said I'd be bolder. It's your fault. You didn't say I'd be mean. I don't care. When you get to be a certain age, you just don't care. I tossed somebody out of Jubilee Disfellowship yesterday. I kind of like it. I love her scouting. Wolves and sheep clothing. I've been around long enough to know that quick. And I said, this is the end of this conversation. You're not welcome here anymore. Security, escort them off the property. Well, where's the love? I love every all God's sheep, and I don't want wolves in there messing it up. And the other sheep. I'm teasing. You know what I mean. Okay, let me give you a scripture. Let's do this together. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You notice the preposition in, the noun Him. In Him, you'll never perish. In Him, you have eternal life.
Yes.
Whosoever believeth in Him. How many of you believe in Jesus?
Yes.
How many of you believe in Santa Claus? Harold and Elizabeth. I love the King James Bible, but sometimes Bible translators really are commentators. And their choice of words changes the way we look at Scripture. And the pronoun there is not the pronoun in. There are two words in the King James Bible, two Greek words that are both translated in. And one sounds like our English word in, it's E-N, pronounced in. And the other one is E-I-S, pronounced ice. And this is not the first one, the E-N, this is the E-I-S. And it should be said this way. Whosoever believeth into Him shall never perish, but have everlasting life. Here's what people don't get about the gospel. We teach everyone, you need to invite Jesus into your life. And we miss the point. He has invited you and me into His life. Praise God. To share His victory. To share His success. Share His righteousness, to share His authority, to share His dominion, to share His wisdom, to share His peace.
Hallelujah!
He said, I'm the door, by me you enter in.
He
said, I'm the door to the sheepfold, and by me you can go in and out and find pasture. And most of God's people are out more than they're in. That went over big. I feel it's time for me to adjourn. Think about it. I won't say it again. With the heart, men believe. Into righteousness. With the tongue, confession is made. Into salvation. Into means entering into a definite place or a fixed time. You came into the sanctuary tonight.
Yeah.
A lot of people see Jesus like a church on a corner.
And they recognize that there is a Jesus. And they don't deny that there is a Jesus. But honey, believing in Jesus is not enough. I know you're going to jump to conclusions there. But devils believe and tremble. Believing in something or in someone is not enough. We have the life of God when we step into Christ. When we abide with Christ. When He shares His life with us and His joy with us and His righteousness with us. It's one thing to believe in righteousness. It's another thing to believe into the state of right standing with God. Praise the Lord. It's one thing to believe in healing. It's another thing to step into divine healing. Hallelujah. And it's no more just a concept or a possibility, but it is a reality. It's where you live. Praise God. You see where I'm going with this? One preposition can change our entire theology. If any man is in Christ, if he's come into Christ, if he stepped out of his old life and come into the new life that God has made available to us, then he is a new creature.
Yes, amen.
In him you're a new creature. You became a new creation by believing into. How did you believe into? You believed His word. You believed His promises. You confessed it with your mouth. And guess what? You were translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son. You're in a different place than the people in the world. You have a different environment than the people in the world. A lot of them out there believe in Jesus, but they have not stepped into Jesus. Well, let me just say something to you. I believe in Muhammad. There was a person called Muhammad. It's a historical fact, and I would be crazy not to recognize that there was someone, a founder of Islam, named Muhammad. But I have not stepped into Muhammad. I have not stepped into Islam. I recognize that there was a Muhammad. There was a Siddhartha. There was a Buddha. He actually existed. But it's one thing to acknowledge the historical fact. It's another thing to enter into that life and that lifestyle and those values and those qualities. And I haven't entered into Buddha and I haven't entered into Mohammed, but I have stepped over into Jesus and my life is hid with Christ in God. Hallelujah. I've been translated. I've been raised up in heavenly places, seated with Him in heavenly places. Hallelujah. I want to go into some new things. I want to go into some places I haven't been before. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. It's not a one-room shack.
Hallelujah.
Out in the woods. It's a place with many rooms. And every room has a specialized function. And a lot of people are just living on the front porch of Christianity. But you know, Jesus is welcoming you and I to take up our permanent abode inside the Father's house. Don't sit on the front porch. Come on in the door. Hallelujah. Praise God. In my Father's house, there are many, many places to live. He's got a place for you. Hallelujah. He's got a place for me. He had a place for old Elijah. He told Elijah, you go anoint him to occupy your room. Hallelujah. I've got a room. Hallelujah. I've got a place in Christ. I stepped into it. It's called prophet. I stepped into it. I'm in my room in Father's house. There are many places. This is the place I happen to occupy. There's a banqueting table. Let's occupy the banqueting room. There's the secret place. Let's go into the chamber and be free and worship the Holy Spirit and be covered with His glory. Let's enter into the study and open up the Word of God and study God's Word. It seems like all of God's children just want to be in the rumpus room all the time. There are some other places to go in God. Think about what you're missing out. There's areas of revelation. There's areas of impartation. There are areas of authority. And we need to occupy the place that God has for us.
Amen.
You're stepping into a place of further revelation. words that are going to impact the nation. You're not just redundant, you're not retired, you're not overlooked, you're not set aside, but God's got something that He put inside of you that you need to share. He's taking you to that place where you've been a time or two, but now you're going to spend quality time, and God's going to open and unlock mysteries. I told you I'd make people cry. Lift your hands, everybody. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Darren? I probably prophesy this to you every time I see you. That's what I see because it's who you are. The treasure room.
Amen.
You're going to occupy high finance in Father's house. He's equipped you. He's trained you. He's given you the experience. He's given you insight, revelation, not just into the world's way of doing things, but in the kingdom finances. It's not going to diminish. It's not going to go away. It's always is here to stay. More revelation. And more finances. Here's a scripture for you. You've been faithful over another man's wealth. God's going to make you ruler over your own. Give the Lord a hand. Let's turn the air conditioner on to sub-zero.
Amen. I go to that.
Harold, you're stepping into commanding faith. You'll decree a thing and it will come to pass. No more asking. No more repeating. No more pleading. Commanding faith. You'll say it without equivocation. You'll mean what you say and say what you mean. You'll speak to the wind and the sea and we'll obey. Commanding faith. Commanding faith, it's a new place. You're stepping over into it right away. You're very good, very, very good. When you die, you go to Bedford, Oregon. God only sends His good people to Bedford, Oregon. Do you have any hills around Bedford? I see you on top of the hill with your hands stretched out, praying over that valley. Commanding revival, commanding blessings. I see you with your hands stretched out over that that valley. And this prophet here in front of me has decreed, and it surely shall come to pass, says the Lord. Praise God. Lift your hands, everybody, and worship Him, and worship Him, and worship Him, and worship Him. Praise God. Hallelujah. Mike, Pastor Mike, Pastor Mike. Praise the Lord. Stepping into a new place. Stepping into a new room. Stepping into a new office. You've been in the functioning as an assistant, an associate, and you're ready to step over into yet a new level of authority and divine ability. And this is going to be a place where you can use your faith and you can believe and you will achieve even more than you believe, because God has given you the authority to occupy this new place in your life. Praise God. Praise God. I've got a couple of words for people here tonight. You can go ahead and start ministering to the Lord there.
Thank you, Lord.
I was in Mexico at an outdoor restaurant. There was an American couple. We were in Guanajuato. If you're curious, not a lot of people. Not a lot of Americans show up here. And this couple noticed that my wife and I were from the States. And
wanted to chat. And I asked him, just trying to make a polite conversation, I said, where are you from? They said, oh, a place you've never heard of. Denair. I said, oh, you mean right across the tracks from Turlock, just south of Modesto, over near Chowchilla, Los Banos, and Madera. They said, you've been around a bit. I said, well, I know Denair. I've been here. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah. There's a place of worship. And you've touched on it. And you've seen it. And come right up to that beautiful shore. But God's going to take you into a further place. Beyond what you've ever done before. And worship is the key that opens the gates. Worship is the key that takes you into that other place. I can see God standing at the door beckoning. Warren, come up. Come up. Come in. Come through. I've got another room. I'm getting all these analogies here tonight. What's, anybody can tell me what is, what Sedalia is? What's a Sedalia? What's a Sedalia? Anybody know?
Arizona.
What's a, not Sedona, Sedalia. What's a Sedalia? I'm the only person here that knows what a Sedalia is. What's a Sedalia? It's an onion. It's an onion. You know, there's a reason God has people everywhere. And there's a reason behind every name. Sedalia. Praise God. Yes, I mean, the Jews wanted to go back to Egypt because they had Sedalia back here. Along with leeks and garlic. You know what an onion is. You probably heard the analogy about you peel the onion. You peel the onion. You peel the onion. I hope you like this, but you're getting peeled, brother. God's taking off another layer and another layer and going deeper and closer to the heart and closer to the germ and closer to the very essence in the DNA. Step by step, layer by layer, deeper every day. Deeper in revelation, deeper in wisdom, deeper in understanding, knowledge, and power. God's taking you further and deeper. And this is your time. And this is your hour. There's a reason why you're in Sedalia. Even though it may not be clear, but it's going to be clear. In fact, it's very near. In fact, it's already here. Everybody lift your hands. There's another place further than you've ever been before. God's opening up another door. God's opening up another door. Are you ready to step over? Are you ready to step into that new place that God has for you?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Jesus is the door. No one comes in except by Him. Are you ready to enter in? Are you ready to enter in? Yes, I'm ready to enter in. I want to step into you. I want to know things I've never known. I want to do things I never could do. I'm going to enter into you. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Everybody say, I'm ready to enter into a new place in Father's house. A new place. I'm ready to enter into a new place. Are you ready to enter into that new place that God has for you? It's happening. It's happening. You just be willing to step when He calls, when He beckons. You follow. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. I learned something about the prophet's ministry. It kind of came to me over the years, here and there. Some spiritual insights, some conversations I've had with Jesus, some experiences I've had. And it has to do with the idea of a cover, of a shelter. You see, when you receive a prophet, in a figure, you're receiving a type of covering. Your pastor covers you. We in the ministry have others who cover us. I have been accountable to Dr. John Avanzini for the past 25 years, ever since Dr. Summerall died. Dr. Summerall was my covering for many, many years. It's hard to find another Dr. Summerall, but I'll tell you, Dr. Avanzini has been a good blessing in my life. Thank you for it. And of course, I'm submitted and committed to Brother Dick Burnell. I honor him. I was his pastor, now he's my pastor. I don't have any trouble with that. I rather enjoy it. He gets to do all the hard work, and I just get to look pretty. Hallelujah. I cover people. Cover them with my prayers. Cover them with my favor. Cover them with my faith. You see, it's beyond just getting a word every now and then. Some people think, well, you have a prophet who's going to call you up every day and give you a word. No, that's not how it works. That Syrophoenician woman had Elisha in her life for 30 years. But we read about, you know, three or four times that he had something to say or do, but the rest of the time she was still covered.
Yes, she was.
See what I'm saying with that? Anoint Elisha to be prophet in your room. I've got a pretty big room. There's room for others. Hallelujah. There's room for others. I figure that my name is prophetic too. I'm Huggins. Which is a type of a cover. I hug people. I hug strangers. I've got an anointing on me. Everybody hugs me. Everybody does it. I say, what's your name? I'll say, Larry Huggins. You need 7 hugs a day or you're going to go nuts. Then I'll say, if you have your hug today, they'll hug me. I hug people all the time, huh? I haven't been in place 2 minutes, so I'll be hugging everybody there. What am I doing? I'm covering people. I'm covering with love. I'm covering with faith. I'm covering them. Covering them. Covering them. Covering them. Pastor John's got you covered here tonight.
Yeah.
I'm going to tap out here, buddy.
Hey, what was that? Whoa! What was that? Hey! Woo! Hey, man, well, you did what you put the man down. Hallelujah. I ain't going to hug anybody that doesn't want to hug. But who would not want a hug from Brother Huggins? Just like getting a hug from Jesus. Hallelujah. I mean Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, Lord. 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 You know what? If Jesus was here, we'd have a line on the hug. Take a picture with him, you know, get next to Jesus. Take a selfie. And his picture wouldn't come out. Right. I'm going to bless some people here tonight.